نستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فالله يجزي عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأولدنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ عليها أبدا. اللهم آمين. We have been addressing the issue of the condition of our Ummah. How did it come where it is, and how we should treat this situation to change our position and improve the conditions, at least for our next generation. We know from reading the Quran that the most important issue attached to Islam is the description given to this Islam in the Quran itself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Islam as إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. The only deen that Allah has for us humanity, not just Muslims, is Islam. The only thing He accepts is to surrender and submit your will to His will. Another description, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ دِينًا مِمَّنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهَهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ وَاتَّبَعَ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا عليه السلام. So who is better in faith than the one who submits his faith to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? أَسْلَمَ وَجْهَهُ لِلَّهِ, which means wherever Allah directs him or them, they go. It's not the opposite. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this deen is described in the Quran as deenan qiyaman. And I want to spend some time on this term, even though we explained it before briefly, but it is important to understand the application and the implications of this term, qiyaman. Qiyam, you can translate it as values. Qiyam, you can translate it also as created values, values that you add to this life or to your resources or to somebody else, or values that you place importance for. And this life is all based on values. We conduct business on the basis of value. When you go to buy something, if it is not worth your money, you don't buy it, right? If you know you can get it cheaper somewhere else, you calculate your risk and your benefit and your time and say, I'm better off buying it from the other place, or I'm going to save some pennies of transportation and buy it here. It's more expensive, but the value you place decides what you want to do. Allah has told us that this life has a value. It has a figure, it has a number attached to it. It's like the dollar figure that you attach to something you buy or sell. You say, I can sell you my home, but no less than $300,000-$400,000. That's the value of the home in my calculations. Then you say, no, but it needs a lot of repair, a lot of remodeling. This is run down, this is broken down, this. I can give you only $200. If we agree to your price, the sale is done. If you agree to my price, the sale is done. If we disagree, the sale is not done. This is what we do with values in our real life, right? What is the point? The point is, when Allah tells us the value of this life, in contrast to the value of the hereafter, then we make a choice. We decide which value is better in our lives. It is like if somebody offers you two opportunities for job. What do? You apply it, you file your papers with an employment agency, and they tell you we have two opportunities for you. One in Washington here, and one you need to travel a bit, but it will give you much more, and life over there is much cheaper than in Washington. You make up your mind. How do we make up our mind in terms of decision? We place a value. You say, yes, Washington is expensive, and it's not paying me much, but I'm living. But if I move, then I have to take new risks that I don't know, and I have no experience with life in the new place. Yes, it will give me more money, but my kids need the schools I have in Washington. Then you tip the balance by adding one element to your calculations, and you say, here is where I want to be. Likewise, Islam tells us that you are not rewarded for the product that you put out. You are more rewarded for your intention plus your effort more than achieving a certain result. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. He is saying, to get what I have, you have to give me what I tell you. If you don't give me, I'm not going to give you. So where does our ummah stand? Where do we, and how do we determine where does our ummah really value what Allah values? If our values are His values, then the deal is done. رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ أَبَا يَحْيَى. Suhaib ibn Sinan al-Rumi was a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when he came to migrate from Mecca to Medina, the mushrikeen, the kuffar of Mecca, they stopped him at the outskirts of Mecca. And they said, listen man, you came to us poor, and you made your wealth doing business with us. If you want to join Muhammad, you leave your wealth and everything you've made of money, because it's our money. Look at this. It's our money. Suhaib did not hesitate. Suhaib, who worked very hard for years to make the wealth he had, he said, so if I tell you where my money is, would you let me go? Because it was his life or his wealth. Nothing third option. So they said yes. He said, okay, my wealth is in that place, that place, that place. They sent somebody, captured what he had, and they let him go. The Prophet ﷺ received him in Medina, and he had the news. Allah had told him what happened. So he receives him saying, رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ أَبَا يَحْيَى رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ أَبَا يَحْيَى رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ أَبَا يَحْيَى. O Aba Yahya, the father of Yahya, your sale is a good deal. The sale that you sold is a good deal. And this is the reality of إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. If Suhaib did not value the outcome of his deal, he wouldn't have gone through the deal. He wouldn't. But he valued the outcome. Some people value the process more than the outcome. Some people value their feelings more than the outcome. Some people value their comfort over the outcome. Some people value the ease of the process or the difficulty therein over the outcome. So it depends. Everybody has their own ways of judging what matters to them the most. How do we know what matters to Suhaib and what matters to other migrants like him who were forced to migrate under persecution and oppression and torture? How do we know what values they placed and how much they value? And to also, how do we measure what is valuable for us? The issue is very simple. It's very simple. Allah has given us everything we have. وَمَا بِكُمْ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Whatever gifts or blessings Allah has given you, it is from Him. It's a gift. وَمَا بِكُمْ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Then, ثُمَّ إِذَا مَسَّكُمُ الضُّرُّ فَإِلَيْهِ تَجْأَرُونَ. And when you feel any harm or danger, you just scream loud prayer to Allah. فَذُو دُعَاءٍ عَرِيضٍ. When we are hurting, we pray a lot and we pray longest. But when we are comfortable, we don't. So Allah will treat us in a way that's consistent. Because if you do not value Allah, if you do not value the gifts He has given you, if you squander what He gave you, then you lose. You lose. فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. Those who go against the will of Allah, they are the real losers. So our ummah could only know what we value by looking at how do we use and spend our resources. And this is the point that I want to reach with you. Looking at the conditions and the way our ummah is living, I'm talking about the Muslim ummah, you find that either the tyrant sorcerers are trying to convince us that this life is the end all and be all and we follow their lead, or that they take from us everything that we have so that they control our behavior, or they scare us either over what we have lest we lose it, or what we don't have lest we never get it. If we accept to place values on their threats, on the fear they want to pump in us, we lose. Because if you fear anyone other than Allah, you lose. مَنْ خَافَ غَيْرَ اللَّهِ خَوَّفَهُ اللَّهُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. وَمَنْ خَافَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ خَوَّفَ اللَّهُ مِنْهُ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. If you fear only Allah, Allah will make everything and everyone fear you. One of the things that we Muslims need to understand is the fact that the issue of terrorism and the fight and the war on terror and all of this is to create fear in the hearts of the Muslims by the claim that the non-Muslims are afraid of us. They are so fearful, they claim, that they want to obliterate our nations so that they feel safe. This is their value, but the point is not whether they value that or that. The issue is, what do we value? Where do we spend our time, money, life, and resources? We are watching movies. We are looking for entertainment tools. We are on electronic games, young and old. We are not putting time to learn even the basics of our deen. Unless we have a problem, we don't even ask about our deen. Which means what? We are not valuing the presence, the gift that Allah has given us, which is the deen. The best of blessings Allah has given our ummah is the deen, the knowledge, the faith, the comfort of following Allah's lead and guide. This is our strength. We are leaving that strength aside and we are trying to calculate how much and how many sources of other powers we have. It is like somebody who has cut his own knees on his way to prepare for a marathon. If you do not value your deen, you are not ready to enter the race of truthfulness and righteousness and justice. And you get nothing of that without sacrificing. But the only way to sacrifice is to appreciate the value of the outcome. That's why the Quran tells us very clearly, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They have never appreciated Allah the way He ought to be appreciated. That's why the Quran tells us, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. Fear Allah the way He ought to be feared. Not only when you want something, not only when you are afraid for something. So when we do not value what Allah placed very high value on, which is what we need the most. Allah has placed a huge value on our freedom as humans. Every human has the right to be free, even to deny Allah or to believe in Allah. Every human has that choice. God gave a right for everybody to choose what to believe, how to believe, how to practice their faith. It doesn't mean that Allah doesn't have guidance as to what to believe or how to believe. He has the guidance, but He has given us humans the free will to believe or not believe. And after you believe, He has given you a sub-choice to be an obedient, committed believer or a non-committed, disobedient believer. That also is a sub-choice, because this is the criteria by which Allah will reward or punish every human being. It is based on what we do. And the choices we have determine our fate in the hereafter. The choices you have in this life, which we have every day, lots of choices and decisions to make every single day. Every single day, you have the choice to be good and righteous, and the choice, the opposite choice, to be wicked and evil. It's a choice. So the value you place on the benefits of being righteous and the risks of being righteous, in contrast to the value and the benefits of being wicked or evil, and the outcome of that, your appreciation will determine where you want to go. So this is what it means to follow and track the values of both what you have and what you want. So the childish attitude that is embedded in many people, that if I label something as difficult, that means I'm not going to do it. If I say I will try, it means I don't plan to succeed, I will only try. And that means that the choices people make are based on the comfort level of the effort and the process, not the value of the outcome. While in real material life, we put a lot of effort to achieve something that may be very small in our life. Very small. Look, for example, people who spend 20 years in studies to become an engineer, to become a doctor, to become whatever, 20 years of their life, which is almost 30% of their adult life or more, are spent in studying. Was it always easy? Not necessarily. But why do people persist and commit and apply themselves to the task of study unless they value the outcome? Why do people go through surgeries when it is very painful? Because we value the outcome. We want to get rid of something in our body, even though it's physically in our body, but we want to get rid of it because of the value of the outcome. If your kidney or any organ in your body gives you a lot of pain, consistent suffering, disabling, crippling effects, then you go to the doctor and he says, because your kidney is not working, you have to remove it. What do? You remove it. Even though it's 50% of the plant that processes poison and pollutants in your body. But you get rid of it. Why? The value of the outcome. So even with the childish attitude that we normally apply happily in our material life, we could have been a much better nation if we apply the same to our spiritual life. So the only reason that is across the board in every nation in our ummah that we are backward, downward, oppressed, occupied, torn apart, killed, maimed, living in chaos and mayhem, it is because we were afraid for what we don't want to happen. The fear of what we are afraid of renders us as submissive to the results of that fear. But if instead we fear the fate that we are crafting with our own hand, I gave the example last week of a community that kept begging to live and let live in their relationship with their tyrants. Their tyrants grab all the resources and they leave them not even the crumbs, they leave them nothing. But they say, but at least we are alive. So long as we use the at least idea, we will always be the least, we will always be given the least, and we'll always achieve nothing even close to the results that we want. Not for ourselves, not for our children, because our criteria is the least. At least we are not like Iraq. At least we are not like Syria. At least we are not like Yemen. At least we are not like Libya. Fine, stay where you are. But you will discover that those who stood up for their rights are not going to be left with the least. Eventually, they will succeed, even after a period of time. Mind you, there is not a single nation in the world, in history, current or the past, that achieved glory and power without sacrifice. An ummah that doesn't sacrifice is an ummah that does not produce anything. You have the grains in your hand. Unless you put them in the ground, which means out of your hand, unless you put them in the ground, they are not in your pocket, in your hand, in your store anymore, put them in the ground, give them water, they will never produce anything. So you keep holding it to the little you have, and it becomes so dear that you worship what you have, you will lose it, and you will never get what you don't have. You'll never be able to grow it. This is part of the sunnah of life. This is what it means to say, إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرُكُمْ. If you support Allah's cause, Allah will support you. If you lend a helping hand to each other in the cause of Allah, Allah will help all of you. But if everybody is holding back, if everybody is stingy and selfish, how could our ummah produce a leadership that is ready to sacrifice and lead us out of the dungeon? We have been turning every nation of the Muslim ummah into a huge prison by accepting to acquiesce and please and placate the tyrants who are controlling our lives because we submit to them more than we submit to Allah. The minute we submit to Allah, we are free. And this is what Islam is telling us. You can never be free. Even in the Old Testament, it tells us, you can never worship God and Mammon. You can never worship Allah and worship anyone else next to Him. This is not worship. You cannot attribute power and glory to Allah and to anyone else. All power, all glory belong to who? To Allah. So we have to change how we think. What do we value of what we have? And what price are we willing to pay for our freedom? Freedom, as we all say, is never free. Freedom is to worship no one but Allah and to become a servant to no one but Allah and to serve nobody's cause but Allah's cause. and any cause that is consistent with the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our hearts to understand our faith and to be fearful of none but Him. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اتبع سنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم بفضله يا أرحم الراحمين. Brothers and sisters, we can keep going on and on and on in diagnosis and solutions. But the point, the salient point that Imam Ali brings to our attention is مَنْ عَمِلَ بِمَا عَلِمَ أَوْ رَفَهُ اللَّهُ عِلْمَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. If you just do what you know that is right and avoid doing what is wrong, Allah will give you the knowledge and the power that you don't have. So if we are seeking dignity, which I think we are under the current circumstances, it is not enough to have a Muslim nation has a nuclear power. We need the nuclear power of our faith that will inspire the entire ummah to stand up and never sleep. Because when you go to bed and other powerful nations take you for sale, you are turning yourself and your ummah into slavery. Now, Palestinians are resisting slavery in their own land. Kashmiris are doing the same. The Rohingya, they don't have any power. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help them. The Chinese Muslims, the Uyghurs, they have no power. Right? The Chechens, they resisted some time and then they were overpowered by their enemies. The North African and Central African nations, their people are running as potential migrants through the Mediterranean, hoping to reach to the other shore at the expense of the hatred and Islamophobia they will meet when even they cross the Red Sea, the Mediterranean Sea. And we are turning ourselves into slaves either in our own land or in somebody else's land. Why? Allah wants us to come back. This is the message. He is pushing us hard to come back. And He tells us that very clearly. فَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ وَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِالْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَضَرَّعُونَ. We have taken them with calamities and difficulties so that they may come back and submit. The purpose is to make us submit. So with all the level of pain that the Ummah is suffering in every corner of the world, with more than 90% of total world refugees and displaced people, Muslims, this kind of pain should have driven our Ummah to the glory of standing up, pushing back, and fighting for our rights. The first fight for our right is to fight against our own attitudes towards our faith, our own attitude towards learning our faith, our own attitude towards practicing our faith, our own attitude towards each other as brothers and sisters in Islam, our own attitude towards oppression and injustices. Those are the things we need to fight the most. Once we defeat those attitudes, Allah will help us defeat any enemy, no matter how powerful they may be. As we speak, there has been a conference in the past couple of days. I'm sure many of you are following what's going on, what is called Safaqat al-Qarn, or Safaqat al-Qarn, or the deal of the century. Our enemies openly are planning the next map for the Middle East. And we are used as chess pieces. They move us about and around however they want. And we should not blame them. We should not curse at them. We should not pray at them, against them. We should pray to Allah to help us overcome our own self-imposed weaknesses. When you give in to a weak individual, you make yourself even weaker. When you submit to the powerful one, Allah, it makes you more powerful than you actually are. Those formulas are not something new that we are discovering. That has been in the Quran forever. All what we need to do is go back to Him. Go back to Him. اللهم خذ بأيدينا إليك أخذ الكرام عليك اللهم تولى أمرنا اللهم تولى أمرنا وانصر قضايانا وانصر مجاهدينا اللهم عافنا واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا وآتنا ولا تحرمنا وأكرمنا ولا تهنا اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأعلي بفضلك يا رب كلمتي الحق والدين اللهم عليك بالطغاة المستبدين اللهم لا تدع لنا يوما في هذه الساعة اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته ولا ذو حاجة إلا قضيت حاجته اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان اللهم عليك بالطغاة الجبارين فإنهم لا يعجزونك اللهم مكن للإسلام والمسلمين في كل مكان اللهم مكن للإسلام والمسلمين في كل مكان اللهم آمن المسلمين في أوطانهم وأصلح أئمتهم وولاة أمورهم واجعل ولاياتهم في من خافك واتقاك واتبع رضاك أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد وأقم الصلاة